Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Divorce Poison: How to Protect Your Family from Badmouthing and Brainwashing by Dr. Richard A. Warshak. Narrated by Daniel Penz.
Epigraph. What goes on in your heart? What goes on in your mind? You're tearing me apart when you treat me so unkind. What goes on in your mind? John Lennon, Paul McCartney, and Ringo Starr.
A Note to the Listener. 8 years after its publication, it would be an understatement to say that Divorce Poison touched a nerve in the culture of divorce in the United States and abroad. Sales continue to increase, along with the volume of mail from readers. Support groups for rejected parents proliferate online and throughout the world, fueled in part by translations of the book. Speaking invitations abound from groups of judges, lawyers, and therapists in countries as far away as Spain, Croatia, Colombia, the Czech Republic, and South Africa, all seeking to learn more about how they can help children caught in the crossfire of parents' disputes. I greet this response with mixed feelings of sadness and gratitude. I'm saddened by the prevalence of a problem that is too often overlooked. Many in the helping professions, the courts, and the media misunderstand children whose mistreatment may leave no visible scars, but who suffer nonetheless. I am grateful that so many readers of Divorce Poison have taken the time to let me know, often with searing poignancy, the difference this book has made in their lives. The feedback I enjoy the most comes from two groups of parents: those who use my advice to strengthen their relationships with their children. One reader said, "The transformation in the children is nothing short of a miracle." And those who learn the importance of resisting impulses to enlist the children in a campaign against the other parent. For both groups, the book has helped parents safeguard their children's welfare. The book puts a name to the problem. It sheds light on how children's love can evaporate so rapidly while a parent sits by helplessly, often encouraged by well-meaning therapists who advise rejected parents to wait it out. Too many parents have learned that time does not heal all wounds, especially when a vulnerable child feels compelled to disown a parent. Most of all, it reveals the power parents hold to maintain a positive relationship with their children and the importance of exercising that power as early as possible. Readers of Divorce Poison sound common themes. Before they were directed to the book by a friend, relative, lawyer, or therapist, many were in the dark about what was happening with their children. Even mental health professionals who specialize in divorce and custody issues have told me they were blindsided by events in their own family. Children suddenly withdrew their affection, and parents struggled to learn what they'd done that would merit ostracizing. The book helps the pieces fall into place by revealing this familiar pattern. In fact, the pattern is so familiar that nearly every email includes statements such as, "I cannot believe how much your description, down to the specific examples, mirrors what is going on in our family. It seems as if you'd used our situation as a blueprint for your book. Did you have a video camera in our home? I have read Divorce Poison from cover to cover, marking with a highlighter everything that seemed to be written about our family, and I've highlighted nearly the entire book." Similar comments can be found on Amazon.com in the many positive reviews readers have posted. Having a name for the problem and a description provides the type of relief that accompanies a doctor's diagnosis of a rare medical condition. The diagnosis is simply a term given to a cluster of symptoms. The cause of the condition may be unknown, the prognosis may be uncertain, and there may be no known remedy. Still, the label provides comfort. It tells us that ours is not an isolated problem. We are not alone. Many parents who lose contact with their children believe that the problem is unique to them. As one grateful mother expressed, "Your words have taken me from a lonely place to know that I have hope." Another benefit of a label is that it facilitates the continued search for new information. When people ask estranged parents about their children and how they're doing, they're embarrassed to say, "I don't know." They answer vaguely, feeling like frauds, and then quickly change the subject. They worry, with good reason, that people who do not understand the problem will assume that the estranged relationship is a sign of severe parental deficiency. Indeed, until rejected parents understand the genesis of the problem, many blame themselves. They obsessively replay past interactions, searching for the mistake that triggered their children's rejection. Their tortured self-recrimination is fueled by the favored parent, and the children who often rationalize cruel rejection by pointing to real yet insignificant past annoyances, such as daily conflicts, loss of temper, and quirks of character. All present years before the alienation took hold, and all part of the give and take of normal family relationships. The alleged offenses are usually so minor that it strains credulity that any adult would regard them as a reasonable basis for a child to lose a parent. Yet too often, children and favored parents find willing, if unwitting, allies in therapists and in attorneys appointed to represent the children. When professionals fail to recognize that a child's rejection of a parent is far out of proportion to the parent's alleged misdeeds, and they validate the children's negative behavior, they become part of the problem. In some cases, it is difficult to determine whether the child's rejection is reasonable or unreasonable, whether the child is better off with or without the rejected parent. Three questions can help make the determination. 1. Prior to the rejection, was there a normal, loving relationship between the child and the parent? 2. If there was a prior history of a better relationship, has the rejected parent's behavior toward the child deteriorated in a significant manner? As might occur, for example, in the case of a parent who suffers a head injury or one who becomes addicted to drugs. And 3. Would the reasons the child gives for the newly developed negative attitudes be sufficient to rupture the relationship without the favored parent's contributions to the problem? The third question is the most difficult to answer. You may hear some people say that a child's aligning with one parent against the other is a way of coping with the tension between the parents and should be accepted. To understand what is wrong with this reasoning, let us look at another transition in a child's life. When beginning kindergarten, many children resist leaving the comfort and familiarity of their routines at home in order to join the class. Healthy parents regard it as their job to facilitate the child's adjustment, not let the child's fears or uncertainty dictate the child's behavior and withdrawal from a normal, developmentally appropriate relationship to the school. The same standard should apply to divorcing parents. Parents who accept their child's irrational rejection of the other parent are failing to facilitate a healthy adjustment to a critical transition. During the marriage, we would never condone such a rejection. When parents claim that their child is driving the alienation, and thus the child's wishes should be respected, they are abdicating their responsibility to do everything possible to help their children adjust to the divorce. Just as they help their children adjust to other transitions and difficult events in life, such as moves, change of schools, birth of siblings, family illness, and so on. A father may have prioritized his work over his home life, particularly when the marriage was failing. The children may have a legitimate gripe, but ordinary children continue to love a father who is not around as much as they would like. They seek more time with their dad, not less. But in the case of divorce poison, the mother may encourage the children to regard such a father as unworthy of a relationship.
Another scenario that I've seen all too often: a wife in an unhappy, unfulfilling marriage files for divorce.
and the husband exploits the children's distress by encouraging them to blame mom exclusively for breaking up the family, and to reject her unless she will agree to reconcile with dad. This scenario is even more egregious when the mother is a battered wife who's finally found the means and the courage to leave an abusive husband. I've heard from many such women whose ex-husbands maintain their control and domination by intimidating and manipulating the children to disrespect their mother, a phenomenon that is well documented in domestic violence studies. In such cases, divorce poison is dispensed intentionally and with forethought, as shown in this comment from a husband served with divorce papers. "I'm going to show you what it's like to love someone and not have them love you back." Unfortunately, mothers in this situation hit a brick wall when they seek help from some groups whose mission is to advocate for women and children's welfare. Such groups adopt official positions denying or showing skepticism about the existence of pathological alienation and fight against its recognition. Instead, they blame the rejected mother for her children's rejection. "If your child hates you," one woman was told, "look within yourself for the reason." This harsh position stems from the concern that the courts will dismiss an abused child's rejection of his tormentor as the product of the favored parent's manipulations. In their zeal to defend physically and sexually abused children and the mothers who protect them, these groups overlook perpetrators who emotionally abuse their children by inculcating irrational fears and hatred and contributing to the tragic loss of essential relationships. To rationalize their opposition to the concept of divorce poison, these groups and the professionals who advise them adopt the extreme position that alienated children's fears and hatred are always an objective and rational response to the rejected parent, totally independent and untainted by any outside forces. If this were true, alienated children would be the only class of humans immune to outside influence and pressure. More than a century of psychological and sociological research demonstrates beyond any reasonable doubt that everyone is susceptible to suggestion, pressures to conform, manipulation of thoughts, compliance with authority, misperceptions, distorted memories, and social influence. It is a simple fact of human nature. It is the rationale for the billions of dollars spent on advertising. It is why parents of teens worry about the company their children keep. It is the basis for television shows such as Candid Camera and How We Do It, in which ordinary individuals succumb to the pressure of a group or authority figure to do silly things. It explains how children, born without malice, are taught to hate other races and cultures. It is what drives political campaigns, as candidates attempt to shape our perceptions by focusing on their assets and their opponents' liabilities. The idea that parents can change the way children think, feel, and behave is the basic premise of the parental guidance industry, of many schools of psychotherapy, and of an entire branch of the science of child development. If children were beyond their parents' influence, bookstores could eliminate the section of books advising parents on how to raise better children. If our upbringing had no impact on our psyches, therapists would have no need to explore their patients' relationships with parents for clues about the origin of psychological problems. Child development specialists constantly provide new insights into the science behind parents' influence on children's thoughts and feelings. For instance, my professional articles cite research documenting how parents can corrupt their children's eyewitness reports through coaching and misinformation. When such studies are combined with the observations and experience of hundreds of experts throughout the world, it is beyond dispute that an angry parent can fill a child's mind with negative thoughts about the other parent. To distinguish irrational alienation from a reasonable rejection of a deficient parent, This book uses the term pathological alienation. Others use the term parental alienation syndrome, and the nomenclature continues to be a source of controversy. What troubles me are the critics who dismiss the entire concept of irrational alienation as merely a fiction seized on by abusive fathers to gain custody. These critics assert, over and over, that the concept has been discredited by scientists. They try to persuade through repetition rather than reasoned arguments. As I discuss in Chapter 6, the tactic of repetition is also used by some parents to persuade their children to accept prejudicial attitudes about the other parent. There can be no doubt that the problems I examine here are genuine and prevalent. Surveys of lawyers and mental health professionals report near unanimous agreement on the existence of parental alienation. Divorce poison is such an obvious feature of bad divorces that all family court judges have seen it in their courtrooms. Estimates of its prevalence range from about 20,000 to 250,000 new cases every year, depending on the severity of alienating behavior. Perhaps the most compelling evidence of divorce poison is testimony from adults who spent their childhoods alienated from a parent. Their accounts of suffering and their poignant regrets over irretrievable lost opportunities give a voice and an image to the statistics. Of all the letters I receive, one stands out. A psychotherapist, whom I'll call Moira, was touched by my book and wrote to me about her experiences growing up. I read excerpts from her letter when educating judges, attorneys, custody evaluators, and therapists, because it provides a remarkable first-hand, behind-the-scenes account of life as an alienated child, blending her personal experience with her professional understanding to illustrate many of the points I make in Divorce Poison. Moira writes, I was about 11 at the time. My first memory of my mother expressing outrage that I still loved my father was when my father took me out to lunch to tell me about the divorce and tell me what my life would be like after the divorce. I recall asking if it would be like a friend situation, and he said, yes. This friend enjoyed a good relationship with both parents, and I recall feeling satisfied with this, and not feeling frightened at all about the changes that would occur in our lives. When I came into the house, my mother immediately asked me how I felt, and I said, fine. And she burst into tears and raged at me for the first time in my life. She repeatedly stated that if it was her father who left her mother, she would be so angry that she'd never speak to her father again. I clearly recall thinking, uh-oh, I'm not supposed to be okay with this. I still remember my father being so surprised and confused the next time we talked, and I expressed anger towards him and outrage that he was leaving us. The rapid onset of alienation is shocking to parents, but as I describe in this book, quite typical. Alienating parents are proud of their closeness to their children. They fail to appreciate that the children hide a crucial aspect of themselves from the favored parent. The children learn to conceal any positive feelings they have about the other parent. The letter goes on. That experience marked the beginnings of my mother's systematic brainwashing of us. Each time I was with my father, our relationship would return to normal, as would my feelings for him. But upon coming home, I was literally bombarded by my mother, who fired questions at me asking me how I felt, what we did, etc. I recall her telling me that he was undependable, that he didn't really care, and that if I still loved him, it was only because he was brainwashing me. Another point I make in the book is that often, the parent who first accuses the other of divorce poison is the one most guilty of it. This is what life was like throughout adolescence.
Whether it was my mother's constantly putting my father in no-win situations as proof of his horrible nature,
or my mother telling my father, without our knowledge, that we didn't want to talk to him because we were disgusted by him, and then getting off the phone to tell one of us that he didn't want to talk to us because he was upset with us, or her encouraging us to write our feelings in a letter to him that she said we would never mail, and then mailing it to him without our knowledge. My mother was also very indiscriminate in whom she badmouthed my father to, particularly anyone who expressed concern for him. Most people backed away from him because they just didn't like the mess, which left us with the sense that she was immensely powerful. No one really saw the truth, so what was the point of fighting it? My father never badmouthed my mother. If we ever did complain about her to him, I recall that the most he would say was, "She hurts the ones she loves the most." A central theme of my book is the responsibility to be proactive in helping children understand and cope with divorce poison. This book emphasizes the importance of helping children clarify reality, something this woman's father failed to do. Now, here is something that I don't think people can understand unless they've been an alienated child. After years of counseling that did absolutely nothing, and various people asking me if I was okay, I always said yes. My father, who had historically been passive and just backed away in response to my mother's caustic behavior, finally approached me about age 17 and said that he was hurt by my constant rejection of him and that he felt as though I was being coached to hate him and was being told things that were not true. He then asked me how I thought he felt in all of this. What is so odd is the effect this had on me. It was almost as if it allowed me to come out of a trance. For years, I had just robotically repeated what my mother said, even though I did struggle with it internally, and my father's direct but respectful confrontation of our relationship broke the trance instantly. My point is that there was nothing to indicate that my passionately expressed hatred and rejection of him wasn't authentic. But it wasn't, and it wiped away far more easily and quickly than I think anyone could have possibly imagined, even myself.
I recall immediately feeling relief and a flooding of all my real emotions for him.
The experience is quite odd in retrospect, because I do believe at that point I believed what my mother told me. But if I did, then how was it that this gentle confrontation on my father's part so easily broke through? The feeling Moira describes of being in a trance is a clue that divorce poison resembles other forms of mind control. It is vital that rejected parents, judges, and therapists understand how even the most vociferously angry children may cast off their alienation when given the right opportunity. I agree with my father's decision not to badmouth my mother, but where I think he made a mistake was in not confronting her mischaracterizations and lies earlier, and not advocating for us more. I agree with you when you say that a passive approach is not always best. My mother had our ear constantly, and we had to go with the program in order to survive in that house. But we also didn't have an alternate option. We didn't have any other input to support our true feelings. Thus, it often felt like we weren't strong enough to believe in our truth without some outside force to support it. When my mother would lie to us, my father was so afraid of burdening us with his perspective that he often said nothing. My aunt later told me just how grieved my father was, and how my aunt would tell him that someday we'd get it. And we'd come back to him. I just feel as though there were wasted years because I could have been convinced of reality much, much sooner had he been a bit more proactive. Moira and her dad are among the lucky ones. Too many children never recapture a positive relationship with the parent they reject. Even those who overcome their estrangement have to live with the painful knowledge of all that was missed in what some call the lost years. A few more things that you might find interesting. My father was actually very easygoing, sometimes to the point of being passive, never raised his voice, and was very reliable. Yet that didn't stop my mother from describing him as angry, violent, mean, and unreliable, particularly when he attempted to stand up to her. I began to believe her characterization of him, even though there was absolutely no evidence to support her allegations. Yet in the absence of evidence, my mother would create it, which made it very confusing for us children. For instance, after my father moved, he would often send us airline tickets for a visit. Often, they would never arrive, and my mother would use this as evidence that he never followed through with his promises. I believe I was about 18 when I found that cache of tickets hidden in a drawer in her room. It is this type of manipulation that leads me to conclude that it is a mistake for custody evaluators and courts to routinely assume that both parents contribute equally to a child's estrangement. I've heard from others who learned later in life that their favored parent concealed from them the financial contributions of their rejected parent. The result is that children grow up feeling unloved by the absent parent, and this makes them even more likely to try to please one parent by disparaging the other. Moira goes on to illustrate something that the therapists in my audience do not enjoy hearing. Too many professionals have a poor grasp of these problems. They not only fail to help, they make things worse. One more thing. The counselors in our lives did far more damage than good. My mother was wonderful at manipulating them, and we simply didn't have a voice or the words to describe what was going on. It was far too scary for us to speak the truth, particularly when she was there in the room. And all she had to do was go in, play the victim of an angry and abandoning man, and each counselor bought it without question. I can't tell you how many times my father was dragged in for counseling sessions while I was given a scripted list of my grievances to share with him. I also recall my father telling me later how confused he was because he didn't know I felt that way. The truth is that I didn't, but did not have the words or insight to tell him what was really going on. Part of me knew it was all a lie, and another part of me worked furiously to believe the lies because it seemed easier and more convenient. I vividly recall a counselor hugging my crying mother by the elevator one evening after a session and telling her what a good mother she was. My mother used this as a weapon against us for years, stating that a licensed counselor told her she was a good mother. Therefore, she must be. My siblings and I are all very close and have talked intermittently about what we went through, although none of us knew until recently that this is something so widespread and systematic. I, for one, become so angry when I hear counselors or court advocates claim that parental alienation isn't possible, that children can't be brainwashed. I endured implanted memories and constant attacks if I exercised my right to have a different opinion or relationship with my father. Sometimes I agreed with her just to get her to stop. And ultimately, I was not strong enough to manage the dissonance of acting one way and feeling another. So I changed my feelings to match my behavior to rid myself of the dissonance. But the truth never really left me, and merely laid dormant until someone, my father, said something which resonated with my truth and validated my true beliefs. Moira shares this hard-won lesson with rejected parents. Remember that she is both a victim of alienation and a mental health professional.
I'd suggest to alienated parents to not give up, to see their children as co-victims, not as abusers allied with the alienating parent, to not assume that what the alienated child is saying is what they are feeling, even if the child doesn't know this. to not confuse bad-mouthing with self-advocacy, and to know that the alienation may not be nearly as deep as it may appear. I think one of the biggest challenges alienated parents must face is that to navigate the crisis effectively requires almost constant counterintuitive responses.
The hours that follow provide effective tools to weather this crisis. My listeners and my clients find these tools invaluable in preserving a normal relationship with their children and restoring one that has gone off track. Whether responding to mild or severe alienation in an early stage or more advanced, you will learn how to interrupt the destructive process and rekindle a healthy parent-child bond. Introduction: Stealing the Soul. Your ex-spouse is bad-mouthing you to the children, often or constantly portraying you in a negative light, perhaps even trying to turn the children against you. What should you do? If you handle the situation ineffectively, your relationship with your children could suffer. You could lose their respect. You could lose their affection. Or, in severe cases, you could lose contact with them altogether. The conventional advice is to do nothing. Psychologists caution parents to avoid criticizing the other parent in front of the children. They fear that such criticisms could be misinterpreted to mean fighting fire with fire and result in greater injury to the children. After years of consulting on cases where parents had heeded advice to be passive and had no success, I'm convinced that the standard approach is wrong. It does not work. Often it makes things worse. As relationships with their children progressively deteriorate, parents usually try desperately to reason with them. Such efforts inevitably meet with failure and leave parents feeling helpless and hopeless. This book explains why the common approaches are impotent, why doing nothing will accomplish nothing, and why relying primarily on reasoning is an unreasonable approach to the problem. It offers a blueprint for an effective response grounded in solid understanding of the techniques and dynamics of parents who poison their children's relationships with loved ones. After listening to this book, you'll be able to distinguish different types of criticism, ranging from occasional mild bad-mouthing to severe and systemic brainwashing. You'll know why and how parents manipulate their children. You'll know how to detect subtle psychological maneuvers in various guises. You will learn how these practices, even those that seem innocuous, damage children. And you will discover powerful strategies to preserve or rebuild loving relationships with your children. Divorce does not always damage children. But when children are caught in the crossfire of their parents' hostility, it usually does. It hurts just to stand on the sidelines and watch parents trade shots. It hurts even more when parents enlist children as allies in the battle. And it hurts the most when one parent engages in a systematic campaign to turn the children against the other parent. When I began my studies on divorce more than 30 years ago, psychologists were most concerned about the damage to children when a parent, usually the father, walked out of their lives. We discovered that a father's abandonment made it much more likely that his children would suffer psychological problems. We also found that children generally did better after the divorce when both parents continued to participate in child rearing.
I wrote about these discoveries and their implication for parents and for public policy in my book, The Custody Revolution.
In that book, I mentioned very briefly my concern for children whose parents coach and brainwash them during a custody dispute. That one sentence, though, touched a nerve in parents and grandparents around the world. They called and wrote, desperate for solutions to the problem, and their desperation became the inspiration for this book. The problem they face is the exact opposite of what I've written so much about. In these families, children do not crave more time with an absent parent.
In these families, parents do not reject their children. Instead, children reject their parents. I heard repeatedly about children who express contempt for or fear of a parent who'd always been devoted to them. About children who lambast their parents in a most unchildlike manner. About children who will have nothing to do with a parent, who refuse even to talk on the phone with the parent. In most cases, the rejection is not a reaction to gross mistreatment by the parent. That would be understandable. And this book shows how to distinguish such children from those whose rejection of a parent is unreasonable. The focus here is on those children whose rejection of one parent results primarily from the other parent's influence. One parent may berate the other parent directly in front of the children, or allow them to overhear put-downs. In some cases, the children are exposed to a relentless barrage of harsh criticisms of their other parent. They may be actively encouraged to join in the put-downs. Some unfortunate children are subjected to a deliberate and intensive effort on the part of one parent to alienate them from the other parent. These children are, in a word, brainwashed. What is washed out of their brains is any awareness of positive, loving feelings for a parent. These children disown the need and desire for contact with a parent. All that remains is a catalog of complaints that is supposed to justify the dramatic change in attitude about a parent who, in the past, had been a source of love and comfort. There are degrees of alienation. In the worst cases, it is so complete that the relationship is totally severed. After years of commitment, years of emotional and financial support, years of loving and worrying, parents find themselves reviled or ignored by their children. They are unwelcome at graduation ceremonies. They are excluded from weddings. They have no contact with their grandchildren. In most families, though, the estrangement is only partial. The bad-mouthing does not sever ties between parents and children, but it does taint the quality of their relationship. It creates unnecessary tension for children and more conflicts in their relationships with both parents. The tension and conflict may result in children who are more withdrawn and reluctant to discuss their thoughts and feelings, or children who have less respect for their parents' authority. Though these children may be less affectionate and more reserved, they're still able to find some enjoyment in the relationship. This is especially true when they're given enough time to relax their guard and experience the parent as more positive than they have been led to believe. Parents are not the only targets of bad-mouthing, bashing, and brainwashing, what I've come to call divorce poison. Grandparents, and sometimes an entire extended family, receive the same treatment. This problem cuts across gender lines. Women and men in their roles as parents, step-parents, aunts, uncles, and grandparents are all vulnerable. And in all cases, the children suffer. We hear a lot about manipulation by leaders of religious cults. Bad-mouthing and brainwashing by divorced parents, however, have claimed far more victims than the headline-grabbing mass suicides. Several million people are affected, and more are added to the roster every day. Yet until now, the problem has received little attention. Most books for divorced parents admonish them not to place children in the middle of their conflicts, but they provide little guidance on when it is appropriate to criticize a parent to a child, and when it is destructive. None discuss the systematic process of psychological manipulation and how to help children resist and reverse its influence. Search the index of every parent guidance book, as I did one day in a bookstore, and you'll find only one with entries on brainwashing or alienation. This is not meant as a critique of these books. It merely illustrates that we are at a very early stage in recognizing and learning how to cope with parental manipulation. In fact, parents who consult mental health professionals most often receive advice that, though well-intentioned, is not only inadequate and ineffective, but shortchanges the children and may even intensify the alienation. This book does not claim to have all the answers, or even most of them. It does offer insights that my wife and I have gained in our psychology practices as we struggle to help children caught in the crossfires of their parents' battles. I expect future research to discover even more effective strategies for rescuing children from divorce poison. See the afterword. Consider this a work in progress. I hope it will provide a lifeboat for families in which a child's relationship with a formerly loved adult is in danger of drowning. My aim is to help parents, grandparents, and other relatives better understand bad-mouthing, bashing, and brainwashing, and to share with them practical advice that has helped other families in similar circumstances. You have the best chance of success if you follow this advice under the guidance of a competent therapist who understands the problems of alienated children. Some parents who undermine their children's affection for the other parent are only dimly aware of their behavior. Other parents may be struggling with temptations in this direction. By exposing the true motives behind such behavior and the damage it causes, I hope my work will dissuade these parents from acting on their destructive impulses. Millions of adults, when they were children, suffered some degree of estrangement from loved ones in the aftermath of their parents' divorce. This book will help them make sense of what was done to them. It will help them heal ruptured relationships. Increased recognition of parental manipulation has brought with it an increase in false accusations of brainwashing. Innocent parents may lose custody of their children after being accused of fomenting alienation. This book shows how to defend oneself effectively against such accusations. Judges, lawyers, and mental health professionals who are involved with families in which there have been accusations of alienation and brainwashing, whether true or false, will find suggestions for safeguarding the welfare of children from divorced homes. Divorce Poison was written primarily on behalf of children. The failure of their parents' marriage is a chilling lesson that we cannot always count on love. At such a vulnerable time in their lives, children especially need and deserve as much love as they can get. Those who close off avenues of love and support detour children from their pursuit of emotional security. When they manipulate children into erecting the barriers themselves, when they enlist them as agents in their own deprivation, they violate their children's trust in a most cruel manner. It is a form of kidnapping, stealing the soul. I wrote this book to help lost souls find their way back to the hearts that await them. I wish them a successful journey. Chapter 1. The Delicate Balance. Let us raise a standard to which the wise and honest can repair. George Washington. Fred slammed down the phone after his ex threatened to take him to court if he didn't pay his child support on time. He turned to 5-year-old Marty and said, "We can't go fishing this weekend. I have to work because your selfish mom is spending too much money." Fred regretted the words almost as soon as they left his lips. The divorce was hard enough on the boy. Hearing such criticisms of his mother only added to his stress. The hurt look on Marty's face confirmed that Fred had, in that moment, failed his son. The father resolved to do better in the future. The divorce was not Fred's idea, and he was still bitter about it. Every now and then he would burden his son with some barb directed at the boy's mother, often blaming her for leaving us. Each time he did this, he was sorry afterwards. But he never spoke with Marty about the harsh words. Marty's mom, who knew Fred spoke ill of her, never said anything to Marty about it. The little boy was left on his own to deal with the bad mouthing. Merrill hated Doug, the father of her twin 8-year-old boys, and took every opportunity to let them know it. Doug refused to marry her after she became pregnant. Ever since then, she wished he would just disappear from her life. But he didn't. He was actively involved with his boys, and he paid his child support regularly. Merrill's anger did not dissipate over time. She constantly maligned Doug in front of his sons. When Doug was a few minutes late to pick up the children, Merrill told them he was irresponsible. She belittled the gifts he bought. She told the boys their dad was a loser because he was a high school band teacher and couldn't afford to take them on expensive vacations. When Doug had to lead the band at Friday night football games, he asked his sister to pick up the boys and bring them to the stadium. Even though the boys enjoyed the games and liked watching their father at work, Merrill complained. She told them that it was too bad they didn't have a father who could pay more attention to them. She even went back to court to ask the judge to eliminate the Friday night contacts if Doug would not personally pick up his children. She was unsuccessful. When the boys told their mother that their dad was proud about winning the All-State band competition, she told them that he bragged too much. When Doug did nice things for the children that she could not think of how to criticize, she dismissed these by saying, "He's just trying to make himself look good." When Merrill became engaged to be married, Doug hoped that this would help her get past her anger and stop bashing him. Instead, she became worse. She started pressuring her sons to call her fiancé Dad. At the same time, she began referring to Doug by his first name when talking to the boys. "Doug's on the phone," she would say. "Do you want to speak to him, or should I tell him you're too busy? Doug's probably going to be late again. Don't tell Doug where Dad and I are going on our honeymoon."
Merrill returned to court, hoping to reduce the boys' time with Doug so that they could spend more time with their own family, by which Merrill meant herself, her fiancé, and his son from a previous marriage.
Despite the twins' strong attachment to their father, she did not want them to regard him as a part of their family. Hoping to please their mother, the boys began telling her that they really didn't have such a good time with Doug. She exploited this by telling them about the fun things that she and her fiancé and his son would be doing while the boys were with Doug. Doug worried when the boys began calling him Doug instead of Dad and asking to return home earlier than scheduled. He wasn't sure how to respond. His attorney advised him not to say anything that could be construed as criticizing Merrill because it might make him look bad in court, so Doug said nothing. The boys were given no help in coping with their mother's bashing of their father. Richie and his new wife Janice were determined to move out of state with Richie's 12-year-old daughter, Meadow, but first they had to win custody away from Giselle. Richie had always denigrated Giselle in front of their daughter, but now he intensified his campaign of hatred. He hoped that Meadow would share his hatred of her mother and ask to live with him. One day, Richie asked Meadow if she remembered the time her mother beat her with a belt. Meadow didn't remember. This was no surprise because the event never occurred. Richie brought up the event that never was several times during the next few weeks. It was beginning to seem real to Meadow, although she wasn't sure if she actually remembered it or if she just remembered her father's account of it. Richie began casually referring to Giselle's violent temper. Although Meadow had never before thought of her mom in these terms, the more her dad and Janice talked about it, the more it seemed it must be true. When Meadow complained that her mom wouldn't let her watch television until she completed her homework, Richie sympathized with her and told her that Giselle treated her too much like a kid. He continued to undermine Meadow's respect for her mother by referring to Giselle either as the boss or by her first name. At the same time, he and Janice indulged Meadow with material possessions and privileges. The contrast with Giselle's treatment made her seem excessively strict and depriving. Richie's maneuvers had their intended effect. One day, when Meadow was being particularly disrespectful, her mom lost her patience and yelled at her. Meadow ran to the bathroom, locked the door, and said in a panicked voice, "Don't beat me." Giselle was flabbergasted. "What would make you think I would do a thing like that?" Giselle asked. Meadow answered, "I know how you get when you're mad. I'll tell Dad if you touch me." Giselle said, "I think your dad and Janice have brainwashed you." Meadow was offended. "No, they haven't," she said. "I can think for myself. I'm not a kid anymore." Later that evening, Meadow called her dad and told him, "Giselle almost hit me, but I got away." He offered to come pick her up right away. She said she'd be all right for one more day. For the rest of the night and the next day, she avoided her mother. In subsequent weeks, Meadow complained to her mom about all the rules in her home. Janice didn't enforce such rules. Janice treated Meadow with respect. Things got to a point where Giselle was reluctant to set reasonable limits because it made her look like a bad parent in her daughter's eyes. She knew that Meadow's preferences would play a key role in the custody decision. In fact, when Meadow had not been sufficiently critical of her mother during an interview with a court-appointed custody evaluator, Richie and Janice reprimanded Meadow. They told her if she didn't do her part to help them win custody and tell the psychologist what a bad mother Giselle was, it would be her fault if she had to stay with Giselle and not be able to move with them. By this time, Richie and Janice had talked so much about the benefits of the proposed move, i.e., they would buy a house with a swimming pool, that Meadow was convinced that she would be much happier if she could go with them. She was so focused on the benefits that she failed to think much about the impact of leaving her friends, school, dance instructor, and close relatives. Meadow was thinking exactly as her dad and stepmom wanted her to think, yet she insisted that her negative thoughts and feelings about her mother were her own and not influenced by anyone. Bad-mouthing, bashing, and brainwashing. All are ways that parents who live apart from each other hurt their children, just as surely as if they lace their milk with a poison intended to jeopardize their emotional health. These three families have one more thing in common. No one came to the children's rescue. No one helped them cope with the toxic criticism. Each maligned parent thought it was best to say nothing.
Having witnessed the damage caused by their ex's destructive criticism, they each assumed that the right thing to do was to avoid any criticism of their own.
They were wrong. The United Front. "We try to present a united front to our children," one mother told me.
"When we reprimand the children, he backs me up, and I back him up.
Even when we disagree about how to handle the children, we don't let them know." "What about when you and your husband have conflicts about other matters?" I asked. "Do you ever argue in front of the children?"
"Never. That's our private business. The children never learn about it."
The United Front approach is the traditional gold standard of good parenting. Experts agree that one of the best ways to help your children survive your divorce is to keep them out of the line of fire. If more parents lived up to this standard, there'd be less need for this book. But it is equally true that too many parents slavishly follow this tradition and avoid criticizing their ex, even when their children could profit from hearing valid criticism expressed in a constructive manner. How do we know when to criticize and when to keep silent? The key is in understanding how each approach can help or hurt children. Maintaining a united front usually results in more secure and better behaved children. We all know that children don't like to witness their parents arguing or saying bad things about each other. I have never met a child who enjoyed the spectacle. It seems paradoxical that children are quick to complain about the way their parents treat them, yet they take offense when other people say bad things about their parents. Can you recall how, when you were a child, The worst insults your playmates could deliver were put-downs of your parents. In my day, we called it ranking out a kid's parents. Stephen King referred to this as breaking the cardinal rule for kids. In The Body, the story on which the film Stand By Me was based, King explained, "You could say anything about another kid. You could rank him to the dogs and back, but you didn't say a word ever about his mom and dad. If a kid ranked out your mom and dad, you had to feed him some knuckles." Children put their parents on a pedestal and then vigorously resist efforts to topple the pedestal prematurely. When peers attack your parent, it is a simple matter of protecting the parent's honor. When the attack comes from the other parent, though, the situation becomes complicated. If a child sides with her critical father, her image of her mother suffers. If she opposes the father, her image of him suffers. Even if she tries to stay out of the conflict, she'll feel guilty for failing to defend her mother. 8-year-old Adrian was so troubled by her father's put-downs of her mother that she tuned out reality. When he went into angry tirades about all her mother's faults, she numbed herself to her feelings. She pretended what she heard with her ears did not register in her brain. This strategy provided temporary relief, but there was a cost. In the long run, the more she shrank her awareness of reality, the less equipped she was to cope with it. When a child no longer needs to keep her parents on a pedestal, she'll begin to see them more realistically. But this process takes time, and it should be the child who sets the timetable, not an angry parent. Adrian's father was so intent on badmouthing his ex-wife that nothing would deter him from his destructive goal. But some parents in his position will restrain themselves when they have a clear understanding of the damage they're inflicting. If you think your ex is open to such examination, share this book with them. Tearing down a child's positive image of a parent is one big risk of dropping the united front. Another risk is that it sets an example that your children may emulate. Belinda consulted me with a problem shared by many single mothers. Her 12-year-old son Chad was becoming increasingly disrespectful to her. He felt no need to comply with her simplest requests. She'd asked him if he'd finished his homework, and he told her to shut up. She told him that he couldn't go outside after dinner, and he said he didn't have to listen to a crazy lady. Crazy lady was the term his father used freely around Chad. The more Chad identified with his father's put-downs of Belinda, the freer Chad felt to defy her authority. Belinda needed her ex-husband to join forces with her to control their son. Instead, Chad's father aligned himself with his son against Belinda. This is what psychologists call a weak parental coalition, and it is a poor environment in which to raise children. The healthiest families are those in which the parents exercise authority together. Though they respect their children's feelings, the parents operate with clear lines drawn between the generations. The parents are a joint force to be reckoned with. They are co-leaders. As a result, their children cannot divide and conquer, and their parents do not encourage that type of manipulation. Of course, even in the best marriages and most amicable divorces, conflict and anger are inevitable. It isn't so much the presence of conflict that harms children. It's the way parents deal with their conflicts. Shielding children from hostile and bitter confrontations is certainly desirable, but allowing children to observe how their parents accommodate differences and resolve disputes in a non-violent and non-adversarial manner can be helpful, instructive, and reassuring. What hurts children the most is when parents place children in the middle of their battles. In some cases, children witness their parents' violent disputes, or their parents encourage them to take sides, deliver angry messages, or spy on the other parent. Taken to extremes, such practices may be part of a systematic effort to turn children against the other parent. Even in less extreme cases, this type of behavior will harm children. Protecting your children from such harm is one justification for dropping the united front, despite the risks we've discussed. When silence is not golden. Many well-intentioned parents steadfastly adhere to a united front at all costs. This is a big mistake. At times, children need to hear constructive criticism of their other parent. I'm not advocating open season on your ex. Before criticizing, you must be convinced that it is primarily for your children's welfare, and not primarily for your own satisfaction, and that the disclosure primarily helps your children rather than hurting them. There are two circumstances in which it is a mark of good parenting to drop the united front approach. The first is when you are the target of malignant criticism. After months of arguing, Denise asked her husband, Evan, to move out of the house, and he did. Whenever he phoned to speak with his sons, Denise took the call and launched into a tirade about what a bad husband and father he was. What bothered Evan the most is that he could hear the boys in the background and knew they overheard their mother. When his sons came to his apartment, they told him that Mommy said he'd abandoned his family and didn't care about them anymore. They also said that she told them that he was lazy and stupid. Evan simply ignored these comments. He was determined not to stoop to her level. He would take the high road. Besides, they were disputing custody, and Evan's attorney warned him that if the children heard him say anything critical of their mother, this could reflect poorly on him during the custody trial. Using some of the techniques exposed in Chapter 6, The Corruption of Reality, Denise succeeded in manipulating the children so that they began to protest spending time with their dad. They said that they wanted to see him when they were ready, and that he should stop forcing them to spend time with him. The phrase, forced visitation, became a familiar refrain. By the time the case reached court, the boys were well on their way to being totally estranged from their father. By failing to take a more active approach, Evan deprived his children of an effective defense against their mother's brainwashing. The boys and their father were not the only ones to suffer. In what professionals call the spread of animosity, the boys began to denigrate all of Evan's family. Doting grandparents and favorite uncles were now regarded as unwelcome intruders. Experts regard the attempt to poison a child's relationship with a loved one as a form of emotional abuse. As with other forms of abuse, our first priority must be to protect children from further damage. This is not a time for silence. Exactly what we should do depends on the motives and means behind the destructive criticism, which we discuss in chapters 4 through 6. Even when a parent has not bad-mouthed us, we may need to discuss their faults with our children. Frank was an angry, depressed man who would periodically lash out at his daughter with harsh disapproval for normal, childlike behavior. When Gail forgot to hang her coat in the closet, Frank yelled at her and called her a slob. Gail was too young to understand that her father's outbursts were a symptom of emotional disturbance. Instead, Gail came to think of herself as a bad child. Gail's mother said nothing. She subscribed to the idea that you should never say anything bad about the other parent. By withholding her opinion of Frank's behavior, she compounded Gail's suffering. All parents sometimes behave in irrational ways that are confusing and troubling to their children. If we say nothing about this irrational behavior, we give our children no help in understanding it. We leave them on their own to cope. And when our children lack an accurate understanding of a parent's troubling behavior, they may blame themselves for it, as Gail did. Helping children in Gail's position is the second circumstance that justifies dropping the United Front. How to distinguish between helpful and harmful criticism. Contrary to the do-nothing approach, I believe it may be appropriate, at times, for one parent to acknowledge the other parent's shortcomings and help the children make sense of the behavior and place it in proper perspective. Note the key phrase, may be appropriate. Whether or not it is appropriate depends on a very careful and sensitive assessment of the situation. If we're not careful, we may cause as much damage as the parent we're criticizing. The need to respond effectively to denigration is never a license for unbridled retaliation. First and foremost, we must maintain a steadfast commitment to shield our children from unnecessary stress and destructive communications. Some parents never make this commitment. Others lose it somewhere in the tangle of the disappointment and anger of a failed marriage. They allow their impulse to indulge personal wrath to take priority over concern for their children. So, for example, they run down their ex in front of the children, with total disregard for the children's need to maintain a positive image of that parent. They may try to justify their destructive behavior by hiding behind superficial rationalizations. Some common excuses: I'm just telling him the truth about his mother. Or, she needs to know what her father is really like. Before discussing with your children, or even mentioning, alleged flaws of their other parent, you should consider your motives, and you should weigh the potential benefits and risks to your children. If this sounds like too much work, if you do not have the patience to think critically about such matters, if you just want to get on with the business of telling the children how bad the other parent is, then your motives are not good. Rather than acting like a responsible parent, you're indulging your whims. Most likely, your children will be harmed rather than helped by your revelations. Some parents do not distinguish between their own desires and the needs of their children. Essentially, such parents operate under the credo that what I want must be what my children want. Other parents are so intent on poisoning their children's relationships with the ex that the idea of censoring their disdain for the other parent would never occur to them. They want their children to share their hatred. I'll have more to say about all of these behaviors in Chapter 4, Malignant Motives. Even parents with good intentions are often unsure about when they should criticize and when they should remain silent. Separated and divorced spouses struggle with heavy doses of anger, fear, uncertainty, and hurt, along with a very human temptation to express such feelings in destructive and irrational ways. Resisting this temptation is a genuine challenge. Occasionally, parents succumb. Most children can withstand their parents' isolated mistakes and lapses of good judgment. Repeated mistakes, though, can be damaging, especially when they become a familiar pattern of behavior. The following test gives parents a tool to help them judge whether their criticisms are likely to help or hurt their children. The Warshak test. When faced with the impulse to present a parent or grandparent in a negative light, do some serious soul-searching. The following 5 questions will help you cut through self-deception, expose irrational motives that could be fueling your behavior, and focus attention on your children's genuine welfare. Of course, it's best to review the questions before exposing your children to criticism of their loved ones. The more you do so, the more you will avoid destructive communication. Still, lapses in judgment are inevitable. Every breakup has such moments. This test can serve as a reminder to be careful about what you say. When you do slip up,
Reviewing these questions can help strengthen your resolve to do better in the future. If you believe that you were the target of bad-mouthing, these questions will help you clarify what is wrong with your ex's behavior. The test sets a high standard by which parents can evaluate their past and future behavior. The closer parents come to meeting the standard, the more they will shield their children from the harmful effects of acrimony. 1. What is my real reason for revealing this information to the children? You may think of more than one reason, but if any one of these does not concern their best interests, think again about whether the children would truly benefit from what you plan to say. If you decide to tell them, you will need to make sure that you do so in a manner that does not serve motives other than their best interest, such as getting revenge, needing to feel superior, or assuaging guilt. 2. Are my children being harmed by the behavior I am about to criticize, or are they being harmed by not having the information I am about to reveal? You may have a legitimate grievance about your ex-spouse, but there's no reason to share this with the children if they are not hurt by the behavior in question.
For example, a man wanted to tell his children, who were raised Catholic, that their mother had had an abortion years earlier.
He insisted they had a right to know the truth. But when asked how his children were harmed by withholding this information, he drew a blank. 3. How will it help the children to hear what I am about to tell them? Even if the children are being harmed by their other parents' behavior, before discussing it with them, you should be convinced that your revelations will actually benefit the children. A woman believed that her ex-husband had been stingy in the divorce settlement. She knew that more money would enable her to provide better for her children, but she decided not to complain to the children about their father because she could not think of how it would help them to hear her opinion that their father was a cheapskate. There was nothing that the children could do about the situation. Her revelations would only place the children in the middle of an adult conflict and perhaps diminish their respect for their father. 4. Do the possible benefits of revealing this to the children outweigh the possible risks? In many situations, there is reason to believe that the revelations might benefit the children, but at the same time might create problems for them. An honest discussion of the other parent's flaws might help the children have more realistic expectations, but it might also poke holes in their idealization of the parent before they're emotionally prepared to give this up. Or it might lead to greater conflict in the parent-child relationship. If, after weighing the benefits and risks, you decide to share your criticisms with the children, you'll want to do so in a manner that maximizes the benefits while minimizing the harm. The next question will help you accomplish this goal. 5. If I were still happily married to my spouse and I wanted to protect our children's relationship with them, how would I handle the situation? This question helps raise your consciousness so that the content and style of your communications with your children avoids the influence of irrational motives. It challenges you to think of the most constructive course to take. If, when happily married, you would not want your children to have the information you're about to give, why do you think they need to know it now? And if, when happily married, you'd find a way to discuss it that minimized harm to their relationship with the other parent, an approach that did not undermine their general respect and regard for that parent, that same discretion is called for after divorce. Remember, it is easy to fool ourselves into thinking that bad-mouthing is justified. Because of the potential damage to our children, we should be convinced that what we say and how we say it meets the test of the 5 questions.
What if we're unsure about whether to include a particular observation or opinion in our conversations with the children? Here is a simple rule to follow. When in doubt, leave it out. Test applications. To illustrate the use of this test, let us look at two typical scenarios that often prompt divorced parents to criticize their ex-spouses to their children. One, reacting to a parent who is chronically late, and two, explaining the reasons for the divorce. A father is always late to pick up his children. This often disrupts his ex-wife's schedule. After repeated instances of such inconvenience, she may want to berate him in front of the children by saying such things as, "You can't count on your father," or, "He's so irresponsible," or, "Your father cares more about his girlfriend than he does about you." When this mother asks herself question one of our test, "What is my real reason for revealing this information to the children?" she realizes that she has mixed motives. On the one hand, she feels bad for the children and angry at the man who disappoints them. On the other hand, she is angry that he is inconsiderate of her needs. She concludes that her concern for the children is genuine, but that if she decides to talk with them about their father's lateness, she will need to be cautious not to allow her anger at him to influence the way she handles the situation. Next, she asks, "Are my children being harmed by the behavior I am about to criticize?" Yes, they are being harmed.
They are constantly disappointed when he does not come to get them on time, and they are anxious that he will fail to show up.
Not only are they disappointed and anxious, but they may assume that their father is late because they are not important enough to him. This could hurt their self-esteem. The next question is, how will it help the children to hear what I am about to tell them? It could help them to have a different mindset while waiting for their father so that they can avoid excessive disappointment and worry. If the issue is discussed openly, their mother could help them find a healthy way to cope with his lateness. It could also help them place their father's behavior in perspective so that they do not regard it as an index of their worth to him. Question 4 is, do the possible benefits of revealing this to the children outweigh the possible risks? The risks are the discomfort they could feel when their mother criticizes their father. Their mother's criticism could cut deeper than their father's lateness. Nevertheless, if she chooses her words with discretion, she can help the children while minimizing the likelihood of stressing them even further. It's important to keep in mind your child's age when you decide what to say and how to say it. For instance, some children may be too young or immature to benefit from such a discussion. The question that helps her most is question 5. If I were still happily married to my husband and I wanted to protect our children's relationship with him, how would I handle the situation? This forces her to think about the best way to discuss the issue with her children. She realizes that she actually handled the same issue during the marriage in a different manner, and she can think of no reason not to handle it in a similar fashion now. While she was married, her husband's lateness was a chronic irritant to her, but the children always showed much more tolerance of this trait. By the way, this is true in general. Children are more able and willing to tolerate faults in their parents than spouses are with each other. Armed with this perspective, the mother realizes that it will not help the children to hear her berate their father as irresponsible or inconsiderate, and it could undermine their respect for him. Instead, she tells them, "You may have noticed that Dad is usually late to pick you up. I know he loves spending time with you, but Dad has always been late for things, even things that are very important to him. A lot of people have problems being on time. I wish Dad didn't have this problem, but it doesn't have to be a big deal. Instead of just waiting by the door for him each time,
Find something to do that'll keep you occupied and take your mind off the time. That way you won't have to worry so much. You know he always shows up, and then you'll have a great time together. It would not have been wrong if she also encouraged her children to tell their father how they felt about his lateness. None of this discussion is meant to justify the father's lateness or to minimize the inconsiderateness of his behavior. His ex-wife had good reason to resent his irresponsible handling of his time with the children. His behavior hurt the children, and it caused her to be late for her own appointments. Time is a precious commodity, especially for a single parent. This mother deserves our respect because she handled the situation in a constructive manner. She carefully balanced her children's need to respect and admire their father with their need for assistance in coping with his lateness. She did not allow her resentment to dictate her behavior. The result is that she remained focused on what was most important to her, her children's welfare. It's a more difficult challenge for parents to explain to their children reasons for the divorce. Children will ask why, and they need and deserve an explanation that takes into account their intellectual and emotional maturity. In some situations, the reason for the divorce will necessarily include facts that will lead the children to hold one parent more responsible than the other. As I relate this chapter, I'm consulting on one such case. The mother became pregnant in the course of an extramarital affair and decided to leave her husband and three sons to move to another city and marry her lover. Naturally, the children know what their mother has done, and they're liable to blame the divorce on her behavior. But even in this situation, the information can be conveyed to the children in a manner that does not encourage them to reject their mother. Without condoning the mother's behavior, the father can explain to his sons that he was not able to make their mother happy enough to stay in the marriage. If we feel wronged or do not want the divorce, we may tell the children that the divorce is all the other parent's fault. Question 1's search for motives will usually reveal that our wish to blame the divorce entirely on the other parent has less to do with our children's needs than our own. At least 3 motives drive our desire to assign blame. First, we want to deflect blame from ourselves. We want to avoid accepting responsibility for the failure of our marriage. We do not want our children to be angry with us, and we do not want to feel guilty for hurting them. Second, we want our children's sympathy and alliance. And third, we want to punish our spouse. By making the other parent the bad guy, we manipulate the children to be angry with, perhaps even turn against, the other parent. The message that our spouse is to blame for the divorce, therefore, carries 3 hidden requests. Don't be mad at me. Pity me. Join me in being angry at your other parent. None of these serves our children. Perhaps even more to the point, many people are wrong in blaming the failure of their marriage entirely on their ex-spouse. Though the initial decision to divorce might not have been their own, in the majority of cases, both spouses contributed to the marital difficulties. An honest answer to question 1, therefore, puts us on notice that we may be about to indulge our destructive urges under the guise of helping our children. Question 2 also produces no justification for telling the children that their other parent is fully responsible for the divorce. How can we say that they will not be harmed by hearing this? And in response to question 3, it is difficult to think of any clear benefit that they would gain by hearing our opinion that the other parent is totally at fault. This does not mean that we should deprive children of an explanation for the divorce. Our response to question 4, concerning the benefits and risks of the proposed revelations, forces us to acknowledge that placing blame
gives our children no particular advantage in coping with the divorce, and it creates a clear risk. The children may share our anger, and this will add unnecessary strain to their relationship with their other parent, thereby impeding their adjustment to the divorce. Question 5 helps us identify the type of explanation that would best suit the needs of our children and protect their relationship with both parents. There are various possible explanations, depending on the circumstances of the marital conflict. But most helpful accounts of the divorce will avoid laying exclusive blame on one parent. The children will learn that their parents have decided to end their marriage. They may hear that the parents do not get along or make each other unhappy. They may even learn of extramarital affairs. But they will be reassured that the divorce is not their fault, and they will not be asked to take sides in the conflict, and they will not have to view either parent as the bad guy. Understanding our true motives, the goal of question 1, is the key to successfully navigating the delicate balance between helpful and harmful criticism. But it is easy to fool ourselves. We can shrink our awareness of malevolent intentions by hiding them behind noble-sounding rationalizations. Alice Miller has shown how parents heap even the worst abuses on their children while telling them, "This is for your own good." To get beyond such rationalizations, it will be helpful to review the malignant motives discussed in Chapter 4. Ask yourself whether any of these could be influencing your decision to portray your ex or a grandparent in a negative light. It may help to discuss your intentions with a friend whom you can trust to be objective. Be honest. Instead of quickly dismissing the likelihood of ulterior motives, stretch your awareness to detect even the hint of their presence. These efforts will pay off. The more we are in touch with our true feelings, the more control we have over their expression. When we surrender this control, we're more likely to act destructively and sabotage our children's relationships with loved ones. Divorce is one of life's most painful passages. It's painful for the spouse who wants it, painful for the spouse who feels rejected, and painful for the children. We can understand and empathize with the spouse who feels wronged and wants revenge, or the spouse who is overwhelmed with anxiety at the thought of losing the children, or the spouse who prefers to forget that the marriage ever was. But using the children to get revenge, to cope with anxiety, to erase the past, is unacceptable. Parents must hold themselves to a higher standard. They must have the courage to face what they are doing to their children. They must honor their mission to safeguard their children's welfare, even when the darkest feelings beckon them to dim their awareness of their betrayal of their children. Divorce poison must be left in the bottle. Children deserve no less.
Chapter 2. Bad-mouthing, bashing, and brainwashing. I can see that your head has been twisted and fed with worthless foam from the mouth. Bob Dylan to Ramona. Divorce poison comes in different concentrations. In mild form, it consists of occasional blaming and bad-mouthing. In its more potent form, it constitutes full-fledged brainwashing. Each requires a different antidote. An effective response to bad-mouthing will be ineffective in the face of brainwashing. Bad-mouthing. The period immediately before and after the marital separation is usually the most volatile time in the divorce process. It is the time children are most likely to witness each parent laying blame on the other. You or your spouse may be so tempted to demean each other that you find it difficult to restrain yourself around the children. At times, you may speak directly to them. More often, though, your children will overhear hostile communications not intended for them. Ellen felt so betrayed by her husband's affair that she felt compelled to tell everyone what a louse he was. For a period of about 2 weeks, she badmouthed him, often within earshot of her preschool son. Then one day, while her son was playing with his action figures, Ellen overheard him call the bad guy a worthless piece of trash. This was the exact phrase Ellen repeatedly used to describe his father. In that instant, she realized how her badmouthing was affecting her son, and Ellen resolved to be more careful about what she said when he was around. Preoccupied with their own distress, recently separated parents find their anger and anguish pressing for expression to sympathetic listeners, friends, relatives, and attorneys. Like Ellen, they sometimes overlook the fact that their children are also listening. If little pitchers have big ears, never are their ears so big as during a family crisis. At these times, children's attention is inevitably drawn to adult conversations. They want both to hear and not to hear. They want to learn the details of their parents' struggles. So they collect bits of information, like pieces of a puzzle, trying to assemble a clear picture of the turmoil surrounding them. But they don't like what they hear, and often attempt to bury it in the recesses of their minds. A spouse or ex-spouse who is occasionally bad-mouthing you or your relatives, but was previously very protective of the children's feelings, may need someone to provide the type of jolt Ellen received when she overheard her son parroting her hostility. Of course, we can't expect your ex to be receptive to your advice, but perhaps you can enlist the support of someone he or she trusts, a relative, friend, member of the clergy, or therapist. This person should confront both parents with their obligation to protect the children from their conflicts. Sometimes, all bad-mouthing parents need is to have their attention drawn to their destructive behavior. If they fail to recognize the harm in bad-mouthing, they should think about the fact that children identify with both parents. This means that children experience bad-mouthing of a parent as a personal attack. It is a put-down of that aspect of themselves that identifies with the maligned parent. This is one reason divorce poison diminishes your child's self-esteem. Badmouth your ex, and you simultaneously badmouth your child. If you are the target of occasional badmouthing, don't ignore it, but don't overreact. Comments such as, "Mom ruined the family," may be an expression of pain by an ex who was emotionally unprepared for the divorce. When these sentiments resonate with your children...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.